The goal, of course, is to go beyond all this teaching, all this clarification. And we're rapidly approaching that point. At some point, you realize that the deceptions of belief can be pointed out endlessly. It's very, very inventive. At some point, you just wanted to say, okay, enough of that, all that nonsense of belief, and just go beyond belief. But until that point arrives, one has to push forward with all one's might. The ones who are experiencing their perfection, which is how we all really feel right now, they tell us that we have to push with all our might and continue to do that until we finally just drop the whole belief system of believing what we are, of believing in enlightenment and believing in anything. We're playing the waiting game. Belief plays the waiting game, waiting to become something other than what we already are. And belief will bring up endless reasons or justifications for waiting. Belief will say, we're waiting for enlightenment. We're waiting for some guru. We're waiting for happiness. We're waiting for what? Fame, fortune, success, superintelligence, evolution, ascension, all this stuff. Is anything worth waiting for? Anything at all really worth waiting for? Because as we're waiting, we're not experiencing how we really feel right now, which is perfect. So we're sacrificing the experiencing of our perfection and the infinitely rich tapestry of that. For what? We're waiting for what? Something better than that. At least that's what we tell ourselves. In the meantime, we're not getting something better than that. We're getting everything is empty. Everything we experience in today, look back in today and say, was today really worth waiting for? I've waited my whole life for today. I've waited, which is what we have done. We've waited our entire life just to experience what took place today. And we've waited our entire life just to pay attention to this video and ask yourself, is waiting my whole life to pay attention to this video really worth it? Was it worth it? And of course, the answer is no way, no way. There's nothing that we're experiencing that was worth waiting for in belief in our life. Only when we give up waiting for anything is that's when we experience what we already are. And so it is worth to repeat this and repeat this and repeat this, because what else is there to do? As we wait in vain. Unless we realize we're waiting in vain, we will continue to wait. And our lives will be these empty facades, just this emptiness. You see people pass on, and you see very plainly that, you know, their whole life, their entire life, they were just waiting for something and never came. In fact, that is what happens to virtually everyone who's ever been born onto this planet. Every situation here that arises in this planet, almost without exception, passes on, dies, disappears, without ever having anything that was worth waiting for. And so we're just bringing up these unpleasant facts, because the facts of existence are unpleasant. They're very unpleasant. And so, if we see this, we'll say, hey, I want to stop waiting. But everybody's kind of reinforcing for everyone else, like, hey, let's all wait together. Let's hold hands, sing some songs, say some prayers, do some dancing, bang some drums, do some chanting, do some meditation, all of these things. Let's do it all together, and let's wait together. Let's wait together. And so we're all helping each other wait. I remember when I was young, I didn't want any help waiting. People said I was very stubborn because I didn't want any help to wait. I said, no, 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 no. Stay away, stay away. I don't want any help to wait. I don't want to wait. And yet everybody, you know, pretended with the best of intentions. No, you need help. You need help. You can't do it by yourself. Everybody's got to help one another. They're here. And I said, help do what? And so we have to, we lose the audacity of childhood as we grow up. And so we fall into then a collective waiting. whereas when we're children, we don't realize the social problems of refusing to wait with everyone else. And so some of us just say, no, I don't want to wait, forget it. We're not aware of ostracism because our parents, try to accept us. But when your parents don't accept you, then you start feeling this feeling of ostracism, and then you feel like I better start doing what everybody else is doing, which is waiting. And we wait in vain. And this can be pointed out with crystalline clarity. Well, the previous video, a couple of videos did so. And we're trying to move the narrative forward even more now. What are we waiting for? Is this video worth waiting for? Will tomorrow be worth waiting for? Will the next day be worth waiting for? Will the celebrations of our birthday, of events, of championships and awards and a new car, was all that worth waiting for? Really worth waiting for? Is that what you really wanted? See, well, it helps. What does it do? It helps us wait more, is what it does, right? So the only gift that existence gives is more waiting. That's what it gives. It gives us more waiting. We think of that, we believe it's a gift. At least belief tells us, belief believes it's a gift. Belief isn't really telling us anything. Belief is just believing in belief. We're just assuming that there's some believer. There isn't. We don't believe belief, but belief believes belief. We can look at belief and say that's absolute nonsense. And yet there's something in us that, by us rejecting it, it still goes right on believing. It doesn't listen to us at all. It doesn't pay any attention to us. That's right. Belief believes only in belief. It doesn't believe in anything beyond belief. So it tunes it all out. So that's why we struggle. We can see very clearly what's going on and say to belief, hey, you're wrong. This is a mistake. Belief doesn't hear it, doesn't pay any attention to it, doesn't believe it at all. And therein lies the problem. Because the root of belief is the problem. We cannot convince belief of anything, of what is beyond belief. It's impossible. So we have to turn our attention at some point away from that and to what gives rise to belief, which was the idea of wanting to be prime creator, which is gives rise to belief. That's what causes it. That's what's the causal agent of belief is our desire, of a spirit's desire to be prime creator, to change reality, to force the prime creator to change reality by devising something that threatens reality. And belief believes this is possible. So belief is just reinforcing belief. And belief tells us that there's some I, there's some person, there's some story, there's some evolution, there's some soul, all this stuff. That's just belief. We're not there. Our identity isn't there at all. Reality isn't there. There's nothing there except just belief. Made up. Entirely made up. And we know this, and yet belief pays no attention to our knowing. Belief is a denial of knowing. So the problem is we're trying to have both. We're trying to integrate belief into knowing, which is impossible. Which is just another way of waiting. Waiting for that integration to happen, which never happens. It may seem that these are just word games. They're not. I'm speaking from seeing this. It's just some mind belief can be clever enough to parrot this and sound like it knows what it's talking about. But here, this is being seen and just expressed what is being seen. Another aspect of our problem, which the A Course in Miracles emphasizes, what's called guilt. And when you go at it in depth, what you see is that we are trying to threaten reality, to force the prime creator to change it, make us prime creator. So we believe in threat. Well, not we, belief believes in threat. Belief believes in it. And belief, therefore, believes that God is being threatened with destruction. And therefore believes that God is very, very angry and wants to destroy us. So belief feels very, very fearful, which is called guilt. Guilt is a feeling of, you know, something's very wrong, we're going to be punished for. We're going to be a punishable offense, so to speak. If there is no offense, you know, why feel guilty about it? But something is, we have this feeling of profound punishable offense, something that we're likely to get, you know, annihilated for. And we feel, we're trying to get rid of this feeling. How do we do it? By projecting attack outside of ourselves and attacking ourselves, as it were, but having somebody else do it. We tend to believe that there's many, many, many of us, and there's some of us out there that is not us, and this not us is attacking us. And then we say to God, look, we're not the ones who are attacking you. Look at this other one. That's the one who's doing the attacking. So we end up attacking ourselves, feeling that's going to free us from this feeling of guilt. We say, we're not the ones doing the attacking. This attacker is the one doing the attacking. So the A Course in Miracles goes into that and helps see that dynamic. So that's one way to go about it. I've never felt that approach for me is exactly the way to go about it. I can see what's being said there very clearly. That definitely does happen. So it is possible to look at it and see the whole situation from the standpoint of guilt and attack, and how we try to hide what we're trying to do to God, which is attack God, by attacking ourselves. That's basically what it's saying. We try to hide what we're trying to do to God, which is attack God and destroy God, by attacking ourselves and killing ourselves. Thereby, we believe we've gotten rid of the guilt, rid of the fear of God, essentially. Because God will look at it and say, well, no, that's not the one that's trying to attack me. You know, that one's the one, that's the one who's being attacked. There are various ways to approach what needs to be approached. And one does not have to use all approaches, you know. Doesn't have to say, well, I got here this way, and then I got here this way, and I took all these different approaches. It's not necessary. It's not important. So what we do is we try to see where is the reluctance coming from? Where each day that we spend, we say, why did I wait for this day? Exactly what about this day was so important that I wait for it? And the older you get, the more you realize there's nothing worth waiting for. There's never been a single day in your life that was worth waiting for. Never. If you're honest. The thing is, you can say, I spent my entire life wasting my life, waiting for something, and nothing was ever worth waiting for. I could have, all this time, I could have been experiencing perfection. Instead, I was waiting. That is literally the testimony of our lives. That is exactly the testimony of our lives. And so, what we're doing here is we're bringing up this very painful, potentially painful, upsetting fact, and just looking at it together here to the point where it's not so painful, and that at some point you can cut your losses, as it were. Because you know, if you don't, you're going to spend your entire life wasting your time waiting for nothing that was worth waiting for. And what most people do is they just keep doubling down, saying, well, I've waited 50 years, but if I wait 60, it'll be worth it. Or if I wait 70, it'll be worth it. Or worth 80, it'll be worth it. And before you know it, you're in a gurney in a hospital, and you're being, you know, operated on, and your energy goes way down, and you're convalescing, and you're on all these drugs, and next time you're moved into a halfway house, and before you know it, you put you on morphine, etc., and you're dead. That's exactly what happens here. So it's not only cutting your losses, it's cutting everybody else's losses too. Okay, so let's broaden the problem. Maybe the problem has been, it's easy to speak about ourselves, but the fact is we're speaking about everybody who's ever been here on this planet. They've all wasted their time. So it's a collective thing. That burden is, how can we drop the guilt of waiting for wasting our time, you know, or drop that folly, the regret. And the tendency is to double down, like everyone says, you know, if anybody drops their waiting and they experience perfection, that will mean that everybody else has been wasting their time, truly has been. And so people think, no, let's nobody do it, and then we won't have that regret. We won't have to experience that regret. Unfortunately, that still doesn't get you what you really want. You'll still be waiting, and you'll still not be experiencing perfection, which is the feeling of right now. Yet there is this collective pressure on us not to do it, not to make everyone look bad. There's the stories of people who, like super workers, and they come into a company and they're just working like crazy, and everybody in the company says, hey, you know, slow down. We don't want the boss seeing you working like this, because then the boss is going to start expecting us to, you know, to work that way. Before, the boss thought we were all good workers, and now you've come in and the boss will say, wait a minute, how come you're not working like this one? You guys are really kind of slackers compared to this one. So there is that collective pressure. There's no question about it. And I'm not really sure how to deal with that. So let's get to that point of honesty. Is we need to look and see how to deal with that. That's what's really holding us all back. I've seen many, many people can get it. They can get the basics and they can see it. And yet we do not experience our perfection. We don't do it. We hold back and we keep waiting. Even knowing that this waiting is futile, we still do it. Out of a sense of solidarity, you know, loyalty, solidarity with everyone else. Not wanting to make them look bad. And I always see the ones that who do it. I say, how did they manage to do that? What is the secret, you know, to not being bothered by the collective mindset and plea not to do it? You know, disregarding all those pleas and showing up everybody, you know. How did they manage to do that? And until we can answer that, we're going to be stuck waiting. That is a fact. We will simply be stuck waiting. So it is very, very important to look at this. Okay, very, very important. So let's shift out of that and let's get a slightly different look here. And of course, just the very act of looking at this seems itself to be breaking some sort of solidarity, you know, with everybody, because we're at least considering not doing it anymore, right? Or at least considering not doing it anymore. And that's getting into, you know, territory. A lot of people will feel, whoa, that's shaky territory. Dangerous territory, you know. Because in a moment, a fit of pique, we might say, forget it. I'm not going to keep up this solidarity anymore with waiting. With not showing anybody up. And people say, we're good, we're very good. That's very good you didn't show us all up. I mean, you go to your grave and everybody, you know, will kind of look favorably upon you. Say, they lived a good life. They lived a good life. And they won't say, what was good about it? They didn't show anybody up. Therein lies the problem. That is what I see. That is my confession tonight when I'm doing this taping. Is that we don't want to show anybody up. There's this feeling that we, in order to be good people, we don't want to show anybody up. So we can talk a good game, but we can't play a good game. That's pretty much where I see everybody. Here and there, very rarely, someone decides that it doesn't really matter. Showing everyone up doesn't really matter. And it's important to note that you don't have to have the answers in order to go into an inquiry of something. No. You're just exploring. It's true exploration. It's real exploration. As I said before, my dad was a great explorer, externally exploring the world. And the fact is, though, that this type of exploration, of inquiry into what's holding us back, is the real exploration. It really is the true adventurousness. Because we're going into a question here. We're not sure what the answer is. We're not sure what the ramifications are going to be. And the way to do it is, you know, you sit quietly, you sit calmly, you don't get nervous, you can feel a little nervousness. And just keep your mind steady, pretty steady. Not obsessed about any steadiness, but just saying, keep it focused, don't let it go off in any tangents, you know, and just hold, hang in there, just hang in there around this question and refuse to be bullied out of it. There's lots of people who are exploring the world right now. It's just, you know, amazing. People are just running, going everywhere. Very few are just sitting here exploring this question as to why do we refuse to show up everyone else by showing them that, you know, they've just been wasting their time waiting. Why do we refuse to do that? And then realizing that our lives will be lived in vain if we continue this solidarity with waiting. We'll just end up waiting too. That's it. One day we'll realize we're old and we're decrepit and we're still waiting. Our whole lives have been just waiting. And we'll think, well, these people think that I'm a good person, you know. What kind of prize is that, really? Strange prize, isn't it? You take that to the grave with you. People think that when they die that they meet God and God asks them all these questions and evaluates their life. No, God's not evaluating our lives. Not evaluating our waiting. God's going to say, well, what did you wait for? Not going to say. God said, why did you believe you could die? You believed you could die again. What were you waiting for? Why would you wait? Why did you wait? That's it. No, God's not evaluating our lives. God's not evaluating our waiting. God is not evaluating belief. God knows it's all complete nonsense. And yet we're more willing to keep denying God reality than we are willing to, you know, show anybody up here in this world. Amazing. And of course, the fact is, there isn't anybody here in this world. We'd only be showing up belief. Belief believes there's all these people in the world. There's nobody here in this world. There's no people here in this world. We are seeing what belief believes we should be seeing. Our perception is guided by belief. Perception is selective. It's based on belief, actually. We're believing there's all these people here in the world. It's not true. There's nobody here. And therein lies our escape from showing anybody up, because there isn't anybody here. Everyone is still, in reality, everyone still feels perfect. Everything else is just belief. So we're making some progress here. Belief believes that there's all these people in the world. Belief believes there's a world, there's all these people in the world, and all this stuff's going on. It's just belief. So we get the first part of this conundrum, this inquiry, and we realize we haven't got the fullness of it yet. So what do? We celebrate? No, no. Okay, we just stay calm and say, okay. Just expect the answer to come. That's how inquiry, you know, it's one way the inquiry is done. You have to do inquiry like this. And see what comes up. See what kind of ideas arise for you. What clarifications come up. I don't know what will come up for you. But you don't have to know ahead of time. You have to just be kind of, you know, you're hacking your way through the jungle and you're not sure what's around the other bend. I remember my dad told me he was hacking his way through the Congo jungle with his machete and he came out suddenly in a clearing. He looked out and there was this vast river when the moon, I think the full moon was rising. It was one of those, you know, it was dusk and the full moon was rising, reflecting this vast body of water. What was it? It was the Congo River. He hadn't expected it. He was kind of lost. He was a little bit too adventurous. And so he was lost, and he came out suddenly upon this Congo River, you know, just like, and he had like some kind of, you know, peak experience for doing that. You don't know what you're going to come across as you engage in inquiry. You don't. But the discoveries there are vaster than coming across the Congo, you know, reflect in the moonlight at dusk, after hacking your way through a jungle, suddenly open space, you know, tranquility, you know, you feel expanded suddenly, sense of expansion. But that's kind of a relativistic thing. You feel really compressed and you feel suddenly there's space and you feel the difference between the two. But we're talking about something different here. Inquiry is aimed at something vastly more relevant. It's aimed at us choosing to experience our perfection that is already present. A sense of completeness, holiness. Experiencing our holiness. This feeling, a feeling of holiness already there. It's not based on actions. It's not based on works. Martin Luther said we're saved by grace alone, which means we are saved by what we already are. We already are that isness, that perfection, that holiness. We already are that. We can never be other than that. So we're saved, meaning by choosing to experience that, that is our salvation. And that perfection is not gained by any works in the world whatsoever. So our inquiry is aimed at that. And so we asked, why are we afraid to have everybody else's face and show how foolish they've been? Well, the answer is that there aren't any other people. And belief says, well, by realizing that there are not any other people, you will have killed everybody, you know. It's even worse. But if there isn't anybody in the world, how can you be killing anybody by realizing there's nobody in the world in the first place? See, belief is insane. It's self-referencing. That is the problem. We're not used to dealing with insanity. Reality is not used to insanity. It never will be. It's the problem. We keep interjecting sanity into it and then trying to figure it out from that standpoint. There is no sanity in belief. None. Never has been and never will be. So we can't figure it out. We can't figure belief out. There's nothing to figure out. There isn't any point in insanity. There is nothing to find in belief. There is no discovery, nothing to discover in belief. See, we want to discover something. We cannot. There's nothing to discover. We believe. Belief believes there's something to discover. There isn't. We assume that there is. We assume there's some sanity somewhere. We just have to find it. There isn't. Belief is self-referential. It's a closed system. It's a denial of reality. And there's no sanity to the denial of reality. None. Completely insane. There isn't a point of sanity to it. So by giving up that search for the point, we feel, oh, we'll lose ourself. Well, it's a believed in self, or believed in point of sanity within belief. There is no sanity in belief. So we're not losing it. We can't lose what we never had. can't lose what was never there. Again, more insanity. So it's just a completely insane belief system. Belief is completely insane. So how do we, you know, we say, how do we deal with it? We cannot deal with it. How can you make a deal with insanity, total insanity? And we consider these things, and we kind of like are a bit puzzled, you know. The whole situation is this odd instability, feeling like I'm not sure what to do, not sure what to do about any of this. And that's okay, just to feel that I'm not sure what to do, you know. Doesn't seem to, it's not clear. How can we be clear about what cannot be done? What is there to be clear about? So it's like you arrive at the end of clarity. You see there's nothing to clarify because belief is completely insane. There isn't any sanity in there to clarify. There isn't any. So you realize that clarification itself is also still part of belief. The truth is, we were never in existence. We never needed to clarify anything. It's only when we see we were never there, we've never been in the pit, that we realize we're not in it. It's only when we realize we've never been in it that we realize we're not in it. That is the only way. Because then if we believe that we could be in it, then we start, it's a problem, isn't it? We think, how do we stay out of it? Maybe we were in it at some point, you know. But it's only when we realize that we were never there that we realize that we're here. But we're never in the pit. And in fact, there's nobody in the pit. And there isn't even any pit. There never has been. You might even say that the dream is just, it's just a belief in a dream. Belief is just believing in itself, but there's really nothing there. It's empty. We just believe that there was something there. Belief believes that all of this has taken place and all this is being believed, etc. It's just an instant of belief. We had the idea of wanting to be prime creator, and then there was this instant of belief, and that's it. That's all that ever happened. Just this instant of belief in that, and that was it. Nothing more than that ever took place. But of course, belief, in that instant, belief believes that everything took place, you know, all this stuff took place. It believed in time, it believed in space, it believed in belief. Belief, so it's like there's this tiny seed of belief and then no more. And yet within that seed was the belief that the seed could grow into this enormous tree. So we're really only experiencing that moment over and over again of belief. Just that brief instant where belief arose because we desire to be prime creator, and belief arose, and belief believed in belief. Complete insanity. We experience it over and over and over again until finally we decide we no longer need to keep remembering that instant. Keep bringing it to mind up and again and again and again. At least this is the recommendation of Jesus in A Course in Miracles. And I'm seeing it now that this is so. The effectiveness of seeing it, I don't know for sure. But it seems like these recent exercises I've given out to pray for no consequences, no outcomes whatsoever, it works. It really does work. I've noticed a change in my dreams. All the drama of the dreams is suddenly way, way, way down. And sometimes the dreams will be almost nothing taking place, except I'll simply be repeating the answer over and over and over again. Like, wake up, kind of like this is just a dream. That's all that's happening in the dream. When I'm sleeping, is just this continuous knowing of the answer. Continuous knowing. So it may seem like all this is way out, like what are we talking about here? But it's worth considering. It's really worth considering. I certainly believe that it is true. It is absolutely true. Because you see, belief believes in belief. It is completely closed, you know. And within that closure, that type of closure, it's like a black hole. It's like a black hole. It seems like a black hole, you know. And so we feel like it bothers us, so we keep remembering it over and over and over and over again. It's basically a non-experience. It's kind of a way of symbolizing non-experience, because we cannot experience being Prime Creator. So we had this kind of non-experience. We didn't even have that. We simply continued to abide as we were. But belief, we're seeing this as maybe this was the experience. Maybe this belief was the experience. If we can see it wasn't the experience, then we should be able to just let it go. It wasn't an experience. We never experienced even trying to be Prime Creator. It was never experienced at all by anyone. But as long as we want to continue to desire to be Prime Creator, we will keep looking at that instant of belief as if it might contain something, an experience. And so our looking keeps taking place moment by moment. So we're really living. We live moment by moment, looking moment by moment. And we keep looking into this instant of belief, trying to see if we can find some experience in there. Now, all of this is not academically understandable, you know, but it doesn't matter. Fact is, we can speak this way and see this way and think this way, you know, clearly. Means that there could very well be some validity to it. We're not just throwing out worthless stuff here, and just because it's not academically crisp doesn't matter. We might say nothing ever happened, and we keep looking at this belief and saying, really, nothing ever happened? It's like an instant of nothing ever happening. But is that a happening? Is nothing ever happening a happening? It's not. So it didn't reverberate. It didn't affect us. We haven't been affected at all. And that is the strange kind of this. We're getting to this point. We realize we were never affected at all. We never had an experience at all of nothingness or belief or anything like that. We did not. It wasn't experienced. We didn't even have the experience of nothing. we continued to experience perfection. And so we have to be willing to approach this kind of odd explanation, you know, without worrying about, you know, is it precise or anything like that. It's just an odd explanation. And you just say, okay, I'm comfortable with that. I'm okay with that. I'm okay with it. And just feel, okay, I'm okay with it. I'm not exactly sure what it means or anything, but I'm okay with it. I feel okay with it. That's good enough. You might say that we weren't able to let ourselves down. No one's been able to let themselves down. So that turns things around now, 180 degrees, right? Instead of we're afraid we're going to let everybody else down, what we're really afraid of is that, you know, nobody ever let themselves down. That's what we're kind of like, oh, really? I mean, it didn't work at all? No, it didn't work at all. So there's never been any letdown. We didn't do anything to ourselves. That's what we're kind of, you know, trying to hide. Trying to hide the fact we never did anything to ourselves. Now, why are we trying to hide it? Maybe we think Prime Creator will be disappointed in us. Or disappointed in itself that created something that couldn't, you know, do it, let itself down or do something to itself. Harm itself. Change itself. You know, we couldn't change anything. So we look at these layers and layers like this. We're not coming to an absolute resolution right at this moment. That's not necessary. What's necessary is getting into a comfort zone with these subtle layers without trying to grab a hold of a resolution. You know, comfort zone means you're not desperately, frantically thrashing about for a resolution. It's like you're calmly treading water. You're not sinking. It's when you're sinking that you start, you know, taking in water and panicking. You sink because you're not treading water anymore. You forgot to tread water. You know, let's say we're treading water and we have an insight, and we're so caught up in the insight, we forget to tread water and we start sinking. I mean, then we start swallowing water, and then we start panicking, screaming and everything. We say, oh my gosh, that insight was terrible. But if we just keep treading water, we had an insight, just keep treading, okay. I'm not trying to push, you know, get the ultimate right this second. I'll just keep treading water. I didn't expect, you know, I'm not expecting resolution this moment, so I'm not going to try to throw myself into, you know, that's it. No, it's not it. It's not it. We're just establishing another higher base camp. Just establish a higher base camp. Say, okay, we're just establishing another base camp here, which is what we're doing. Each one of these videos is like establishing a higher base camp. We're not really worried about the peak, you know, the top of the peak. We're not really worried about it. That's not really our goal right now. Our goal is to establish a higher base camp. And ultimately, we realize we don't even need to climb, reach the peak. So establishing base camps is a way to avoid this belief we have to reach some peak. We do not. It gives us the opportunity, as we're busy establishing this base camp, to keep our attention on that. And as we're doing this, we're gradually waking up to the fact we don't have to do anything. We don't have to reach the peak of any mountain. We don't have to do anything to be believed in, anything that's believed in. We don't have to reach something that great that can be believed in, a great belief, a great accomplishment, anything like that. Because the fact is, the subtler it gets, the mountaintop starts to get subtler too. At some point, you're in a base camp, you look up and you say, there is no mountain. You know, there is no peak. The peak is right here. The peak is right here. It's always been right here. We don't have to go anywhere. But the way to do that is not to try to climb the mountaintop, it's to keep establishing these base camps. That's why inquiry and satsang works. It's not to get to an answer. It's to get to the point you realize you don't need any answer. No one needs an answer because there's not anybody here in the first place. There's never been anybody here. But until that's realized, we have to keep working on these base camps. Seriously. Working on them, so we don't get caught up in this accomplishment thing. Like, I need to be enlightened, you know. You're not going to satsang to be enlightened. You're going to satsang to realize you don't need to be enlightened. You don't need to climb the mountain. There isn't any mountain. There isn't any climber. You're still down in the plain there, you know, in perfection. You've been imagining this, you need to climb a mountain, so you've been imagining, dreaming that you're climbing this mountain and all this kind of stuff. And once you've got this base camp all set up, and then suddenly you realize, wait a minute, I'm here down on the Gangetic Plain, and I'm just imagining that I'm climbing this mountain, Himalayas, you know. What do you do with the base camp then? Well, the base camp's all in your own imagining. You don't have to do anything. You can keep imagining if you want to or not. It's the same. No difference. Once you realize it's a dream, you can keep on dreaming. You don't have to stop the dream. If you know it's a dream, why do you have to stop it? If you realize you're just imagining something, do you have to stop the imagination? No, you can say, well, I can keep on imagining it if I want to. You know, if I feel like it, or I cannot, exactly the same, no difference. But at that point, it's just, you know, fun, I guess. Like if you're walking along a path, you see the curvy stick lying across the path, you think it's a snake, and then you realize, oh, it's just a stick. And you say, well, I can imagine it's a snake now, but I know it isn't. But I can play with it and laugh at it and imagine it and laugh at how silly it is if I want to, or I can see it as a stick. Either way, it doesn't make any difference. So you don't have to stop doing anything you're doing. Don't have to stop your imagining once you realize completely that, oh, it's only imagining. Never happened. Nothing ever happened. There's no happening in belief. There was no happening there. Happening doesn't happen in belief. Happen happens in reality. So there was no happening. And of course, we can't experience no happening. Which is why I say it's important to experience the overlay of all non-happening. Because the overlay is a happening. Okay, so people are wondering, what do we do? We wake up, it's a dream. What happens to the dream? Overlay it with unconditional love. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator that gives rise to the overlay. Overlays all happenings, non-happenings, all dreams, all imagination. And that overlay is a happening. So you can continue on with your life exactly as before, except now it's, you know, there's no happenings in it at all. Except now it's all overlaid with unconditional love, which is a happening. So you wonder, how do the gurus, those who've awakened, the awakened ones, how can they keep functioning here? You know, I mean, they still seem to be dealing with everything just because of that. For them, there is a happening. It's all happening. But it's unconditional love that's happening. It's the overlay that's happening. And it's everywhere, equally. So it's just, wow, it's just completely blissful. Bliss, this blissfulness is happening for them. But it's an overlay. And so they see the dream is still there. All this imagining is still there. They know it's happening there. Nothing's happening there. But they still see it. It's just they know it's like a shadow. You see a shadow as a shadow. You don't think the shadow is a happening. It's not. It's the person walking who's the happening. It's not the shadow that's the happening. And yet you can keep walking and the shadow can still be there. You say, oh, it's a shadow. Okay, it's fine. You don't have to get rid of the shadow. We don't have to get rid of our lives. We just realize that there's no happening in our lives. There never has been. There isn't any happening whatsoever. But by choosing the overlay of this, the overlay is happening. So we seem, you know, quite normal. Everyone seems quite normal. Awakened, they seem quite normal in most regards. You know, it's just that they know the shadow is not the happening. The dream is not the happening. The non-happening is not the happening, but there is an overlay there, which brings me back to the root of what I've been sharing, is that choose a different idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to this overlay of unconditional love. And that is a happening. And so we say, finally, there's a happening, but it's not anything in the world that's a happening. Because unconditional love overlays everything simultaneously in time and space and past, present, future, all time and space, all situations, endlessly, equally arises as an overlay. And that is a happening. It's not changing. It's steady. It's perfect. It's flawless. That is a happening. So it seems that you know, you function fine reacting to what everyone believes is happenings, all these happenings, but it's not responding to those at all. Responding to the unconditional love, which is a happening, but it's overlaying everything. So it seems as if that one is responding to the happenings of the world, and yet there's this difference that people recognize. They say some difference. They seem to be reacting to this. They're seeing something different that we're not seeing. What is that? What is that happening that they're seeing that is more intriguing than the happenings we're seeing? And in fact, the awakened ones are experiencing the happening of unconditional love and are not experiencing and know that there are no happenings in the world to experience. And it's not, you know, searching for them. So where's the happening? We used to have a saying, hey, what's happening? And, you know, what's going on? Where's the happening? Where's the happening? In the 60s, you know, where's the happening? You know, something happening over there. In other words, we're asking each other. We know it's not happening here. So where is it happening? And everyone would kind of, you know, sharing information like, well, you know, we heard it's happening over there. You know, it's happening over in Nepal. It's happening in Tibet. It's happening over in Pune. It's happening in Goa. It's happening, you know, somewhere. Somewhere there's. there's a happening, it's happening somewhere. So we're all searching for where is it happening? But you never find it. We never ever found it. No one ever found it. No one ever found what's happening. And most of us, you know, the seekers, they finally just kind of drop out of seeking and just kind of implode, slowly implode, slow implosion until death, you know. And you know, I'm calling all these people out, all generations, quote-unquote people. We're really, you know, spirit. I'm calling spirit out, but we can use worldly terms. That's not a problem. As long as the context is understood. Is, you know, don't go meekly, slowly to your death. Don't go with this implosion of dispiritedness. Like I didn't find the happening, you know. You get older and, you know, everyone's very careful not to admit to each other like we didn't find the happening. But we all know it, you know. We wonder, you know, how did I miss it? Must have been someone else must have found it. Must have been, you know, in Madison Square Garden when, you know, 71, when the concert for Bangladesh, you know, that must have been the happening when Bob Dylan came out on the stage. And I wasn't there, you know, I missed it. And you say, someone must have found some happening somewhere, right? I just haven't met them yet. You know, I've never met anybody who has found something that happened here in this world. Never. Never found anybody. And no one, neither has anyone else ever found anyone. And yet this is the kind of the secret that it's like we're not willing to admit that to each other. But we need to. Each generation, younger generations too. You know, there's some super, super wise younger people, sharp, wise, and they're onto it, you know, they're onto it. They say, hey, there is no happening here. And they listen to the older generations, you know, the 60s, people in the 60s and 70s, 80s, and they say, hey, nothing ever really happened back there. Who are you trying to kid, you know? And they're right. They're absolutely right about that. Nothing ever happened. Of course, nothing's ever happening in their generation either. And they're starting to wake up to that. They're saying, hey, you know what? I kind of think that nothing's happening with my generation either. All this high-tech stuff, and, you know, everybody's got smartphones. Is anything happening? Everybody's doing these apps. Is anything happening? No, nothing's happening. Nothing is happening. Nothing's ever happened here in this world. And if we could just admit that to one another and say, hey, this is great. Nothing ever happened. We wouldn't go to this in slow implosion. We would then choose a happening, which is unconditional love. And the fact is, we wouldn't need to implode at all. That is a fact. I've seen it very clearly what the dynamics are. Literally, it is true that we wouldn't even have to die. Wouldn't even have to age if we didn't want to. We might just say it doesn't matter one way or the other, right? What our body does is completely irrelevant. That's just a shadow. So, you know, whether a shadow, you know, ages or dies or something is completely irrelevant, actually. But on the other hand, we wouldn't have to if we didn't want to. That is a fact. And it may just be that all this, you know, distances itself, the destructive aspect of the dream does tend to distance itself. And the more constructive aspects of the dream predominate. Of course, it's all just a shadow. It's a nothing. It's not a happening. None of it's a happening anyway. You know, immortality here is not happening either. I know there are people who say they've met it, you know, immortals. And we think, you know, something happened to them. No, it didn't. Nothing happened to them. I've come across these people, you know, I've researched this. I'm always researching, trying to look for people who claim that something happened to them, they had a happening. And I find out it's not true. You look at them, these, you know, big, you know, icons, you know, growing up, these people are like doing all this really trippy therapy stuff and meeting immortal gurus and all these things, you know, it's like, and now you see them and you say, wait a minute. You realize, they're just slowly imploding. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. You say, son of a gun. You know, wow. And it's shocker. Shocker. I mean, I'm sure that something happened to, you know, this guy, this lady, Swami, you know, this and that, and you know, they were tripping, walking through the Himalayas, you know, and they met the deathless masters, and you know, this and this and that, and you go on and on and on and on. And even the people who met Anandamaya Ma and Rama Maharshi, etc., etc., nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. Nothing really happened at all. What we are doesn't, you know, isness is the happening. There's no happening in belief at all. There's no happening in imagination, in projection, in dreaming. There's no happening at all. Doesn't matter what we think happened. So there's a lot of people who think something happened. But if you look at them now, which is very helpful, which is what I do, you know, you go on YouTube, you can look all this stuff up, Google it and go on YouTube. Pick whatever person you want to pick, you know. Guru this, guru that. You can go through the whole gamut of this, and the New Agers this, and the pioneers of this and that, and go through history, whatever you want to do, and just take a look, an objective look, and you will see very clearly that nothing ever happened to them. They didn't have a happening. They did not. Other than the ones who chose a new idea, unconditional love arose as the happening. Other than those. So like Ramana, yeah, Ramana, it's happening for him. It really is happening for him. Was and is unconditional love. That is really a happening. Yeah, absolutely. So we go see these, those who are having a happening. Anandamaya Ma, we go, you know, see her, and they say, something's happening here. But we're not having the happening. We think we are, we think we might be, but we're not. And what she's conveying to us is nothing's happening for us. And we want to be dissatisfied with that. And we want to have something happening. We want a happening. And then they tell us, you know, you have to, you know, choose a new idea, choose a new causal agent. You see these people who go into cults, who go into movements, who go into retreats, and you know, they come out of retreats, I keep observing, what happened? That's what we ask, right? You know, you see a guru, you know, you get the shakti pop, boom, you know, and you know, people say, well, you know, what happened? You saw the guru, what happened? We want to know what happened. Truth is, nothing happened. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. We believe. Belief believes something happened. We think something happened, but nothing happened. Only the arising of unconditional love is a happening. That is a happening. That's it. Everything else is not happening at all. It's not happening. Lies are not happening. Illusions are not happening. Mirages are not happening. They're not a happening. We are not experiencing. Reality is not experiencing. It's not an experience. It's a belief that there is going to be an experience. So as people say, yeah, what happened? Oh, so much stuff happened. What it really means is, I believe that so much stuff is going to happen. But as far as, if you look, you know, by over the decades, now you look at these people, you know, they've been claiming that something really has happened for them for decades and decades and decades. Now you look at it and you say, nothing's happened. You can tell it's plain as day, plain as day. And you know, I don't feel pity. I just feel more determined to, you know, don't get fooled. You know, realize, you know, choose a new idea so you don't end up like one of those, and believing that something happened. Nothing is ever going to happen on the spiritual path for anybody. Nothing. Absolutely not. The only happening is the arising of unconditional love. Everything else is not a happening at all. I don't care if you're healed of cancer, you know, if you meet the guru, you know, meet the your soulmate, you know, whatever it is, It's not, nothing's happening there. It's not a happening. And the more honest people can be about this, the better it is for everybody. So I've always said the real spiritual path is simply honesty. That's it. And people always used to say I was way too honest. They said, you're crazy honest. We can't tolerate this level of honesty. It's not, won't work here. So, you know. But that's what works. Is just honesty. Say, you know what? Nothing ever happened. You have people sometimes on their deathbed who are honest. They say, nothing ever happened in my entire life. And that's a fact. Nothing's ever happened in anyone's life. Nothing ever will happen in anyone's life on this planet. Embodied existence, nothing will ever happen. Unconditional love is a happening. To what? To the body? No. To the personality? No. Nothing will ever happen to the personality or the body. But to isness, the I am presence of isness, which is what we are, it is a happening. You see, happening can only happen to reality. It can't happen to a symbol of reality. Or a symbol of the denial of reality. There can be no true happening there. So nothing will ever happen to your personality or to your body or to anyone's personality or body. Nothing whatsoever. See, on this approach, guilt doesn't come up, does it? And letting people down doesn't come up. We've skirted it, right? We've gone around it. And seen put the whole situation on a deeper level. And by doing that, these other questions, they don't even arise. They don't even arise. If we can be honest, you see. If we're honest, these other conundrums that are tripping us don't even arise. You say, waste of time. Why even talk about that? Why even talk about that? It's just a complete waste of time. If we can be honest. Honesty is the real path. We say, hey, you know, nothing ever happened. And yet that we have, you know, we don't want to, you know, people are like, should I say that? I don't want to name names. I don't need to name names because it's a blanket statement that covers everything, past, present, and future. Nothing will ever happen to anybody here. Never has, never will. That covers everybody, right? I'm not leaving anyone out. So if you say, do you mean this person? I said, yeah. I see, Ananda, my mom, nothing happened to her body, to her person either. Because she, you know, but to her spirit, yeah, unconditional love was happening. But she knew her body was nothing, nothing was happening to it. She says, my body is just a rag doll. It's a sack of cloth. It's a sack of wheat or rice. You know, it'll just, if you don't have no interest in what I'm here for, the body will just sit inert over there. It's just, I have no interest in the body or the personality or anything like that. No identification with it whatsoever. Because she knew it's nothing. Nothing ever happens to it. See? So, blanket statement. Nothing ever has ever ever will happen, has ever happened, or ever will happen to anyone. No matter what we think might happen, or could be happening, or will be happening, etc., etc. Never, 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 never. It's already that way. It's already that way. So, you know, honesty can just say it's always been that way. Just resting in honesty, you know, is right there. That then leads to unconditional love arising because there's nothing else to do other than that. I always felt the abandonment of honesty, you know, on my part was the crucial mistake. And it absolutely was, but the world absolutely insisted upon it because the world absolutely refused to say that nothing's ever happened here, you know? Imagine if you're a kid in this world and you insist that nothing's ever happened here and you're telling people, no, nothing's ever happened here and never nothing ever will happen here. Imagine the response of the world to that. So, you know, somehow I have to, you know, forgive myself for setting that aside, you know, even knowing that this is not right, that it's guaranteeing failure. If you set honesty aside, you're guaranteeing failure. But, you know, people just, you know, couldn't handle that. But it seems like now there are some people that can handle that. At that time, people really couldn't handle it. Because we were in the age of science was taking off, and they had in their horizons this whole high-tech situation, okay? It was faint. But we could feel it. The culture, the world felt it. They said, we are going towards something incredible. And something is really going to happen. Okay? We're also going towards all sorts of catastrophes. Tell you the truth, so many, I don't even want to get into them. And so we feel something is really going to happen in the future. And I said, here I am saying, no, nothing has ever happened in the world. Nothing ever will happen. And people said, whoa. We're not ready for that yet. Let us get to the future. Get to these happenings first. Well, we're already there. For the high-tech thing, we're already there and realize nothing's ever happened there either. Everybody's all, you know, Wi-Fi'd up now. And, you know, all apped up and all this stuff. And you look at them, you realize nothing's happened to them. They haven't had anything happen at all. Completely obvious. You know, so I say, see, I was right all along. You know, I couldn't say that. You know, but a lot of good that's done me, you know, suffering all this time. It's hard to stick to your guns in this world, but right now, people should be able to say, whoa, wow, okay. Now, all these catastrophes that are coming, are those going to be happenings? No, not at all. Not at all. And yet, we want to see, you know, if that's true. But that is, you know, you got to draw a line somewhere, you know. And we didn't draw it on this high-tech stuff. We decided, let's see if that's going to be a happening. And now we know, you know, they're selling us printers. They're giving these printers away. They're charging you like $50 for a black ink cartridge. And they got like, you know, 4 ink cartridges. They run out all the time. And then every 6 months, it says you need a new drum. And drums cost like $140. I just priced one. You know, ridiculous, you know. It's a scam. All this stuff is just, you know, wow. We realize it's not a happening. It's not happening for us. It's not happening. High tech is not happening for us. And I know there's a ton of people in the world who realize that, you know. And I bet just some of the younger people are very keen on that. Because they're so immersed in it, they probably even know it better than we do, that it's not happening. They know it's not a happening. And that's why they're turning to doom. You know, so many high-tech people now, young people, are turning to doom and saying, maybe that's a happening. Which is where I can help too, because I had precognition of various problems that are coming. You know, and say, look at it, say, is that going to be a happening too? We don't want to go through that stuff, because it's not happening either. You know, all the stuff, the Armageddon, you know, I mean, it's coming. It's coming. You can see it. You can see it building up, bit, step by step by step. And every day you think, we're getting closer to some happening. We're getting closer. You know, this high tech wasn't it, but this Armageddon is going to be it. You know, Armageddon's not going to be it either. So at some point, someone has to draw a line and be honest and say, none of this stuff is happening at all. None of it. Don't deny, you know, but not deny that it's coming. Of course it's coming. It just won't be a happening at all. Same old, just like high tech was not a happening. You know, there's no there. You get to a place and you realize there's no there. That's what my dad told me. He visited everywhere, almost everywhere in the world. You know, he finally comes ready to die. And I said, there's no there, you know, there's nothing there. You know, you realize that it's not, there is no this happening there. No matter where you go, it's not there. In other words, he was saying that I never found any happening. Didn't find it. Which was honest, you see, but it was late in the game. Late in the game. Very late in the game. Unfortunately, too late in the game for him. Didn't have to be. if he could have just rested in that realization, there is no happening, and say, oh, that's okay, he'd still be alive. But he felt like a failure because everybody was expecting him to find it, you see? He had a lot of, he had people following him, paying attention to him, because they expected him, he was going to find it. He was going to find the happening somewhere. And he didn't find it. And people felt that he had it, but he wasn't telling them. So things got very intense. But he told me, no, I don't have it. I don't have it. But he said, some people think I do, and they're, trying to, get me and force me to tell them, which was true. I mean, he was scared, because people thought he was holding out on them. He wasn't. He told me, no, nothing. I didn't find anything. I didn't find any happening anywhere. And he really went so many places and, ashrams and retreats and mountaintops and you name it. He went there and no. I said, yeah, there's nothing there. Good. Just abide in that honesty. And you will find that whatever sickness you have will retreat from you, which is very true. It started to retreat from him. And then he said, no, I've got to, these people expect that I found it. I've got to at least pretend that I something happened to me. And then sickness came back. Boom. That's it. But if you're honest, You literally, sickness will stay away from you. All this stuff will keep its distance from you, because you're not trying to have a happening. And what happened was he tried to turn death into a happening, and that wasn't happening either, actually. What else are you going to do when you don't find it anywhere in the world? You're going to try and find it in death. So a lot of people now are trying to believe that they're going to find a happening in death. And I can tell you for sure you won't find it there, because I have remembered my previous lives. I know you don't find it in death either. Guaranteed you won't find it there. You don't find it anywhere within belief. And death is just part of belief. When you die, God will say, why are you still believing in death? Why are you still searching for some happening in belief? That's all. That's all. So if you're honest, like I said, even death will stay away from you. But who wants to, keep the body going indefinitely in this world? Nah, nobody wants that. That's ridiculous. I imagine it's possible that a perfectly, awakened one in unconditional love could keep a body here for thousands of years out of compassion if they wanted to, sure. And it probably wouldn't bother them. That's very possible. But even meeting them would not be a happening for you, for our personality, for our body, for our beliefs, or anything. Would not. But it might awaken a certain inquiry, what's going on here? So a lot of people are prepping for their death, to tell you the truth. Let's be honest. Let us be honest. Again, honesty is the path. A lot of people are prepping for their deaths. They know that catastrophes are coming. Crises are coming. All sorts. And they've got stockpiles of pills. All sorts of pills. They got their alcohol and they got their pills. Mix the two. It's pretty easy. Have somebody else mix it for you. And people are getting to these moods, euthanasia moods. Parties, these parties. People are getting into this thing like, hey, at some point there'll be parties where maybe people will just, drink the Kool-Aid. That is very, very possible. Very likely. Where the collective despair, what will happen is people will be still searching for a happening, and they'll think that in collective death they'll find a happening. Collective sacrifice. People think that in suicide they'll find a happening, or death, collective death. Some people think in war, in acts of blowing other people up, they think that that'll be a happening for them, for someone. See, all this stuff is based on ignorance, delusion. What we are, what is, doesn't need a happening to be what it is. What is the happening. We are the happening. But we don't need some happening to be what we are. But in the meantime, unconditional love, choose that as a happening. It really is a happening. Meaning it's perfect, it's flawless, it's immaculate. It's exactly what we want. That's what's called a happening. That's happening in reality. That's what means a happening is that which is complete. Absolutely complete, without a single part missing. That is a happening. That's why everyone's saying, hey, what's happening? You know, is there some happening somewhere? You know, where can I find this happening? Can I go to a retreat? Can I go to an ashram? Can I go to church? Where can I find this happening? You find it by choosing a new idea, by choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Unconditional love arises. It's perfect. It's complete. It overlays everything. That is a happening. It's permanent. It's permanent, you know. It's unchanging. How can that which is changing, constantly changing, have a happening? How can a body, a personality, have a happening? The very experiencer is constantly changing. Can't be a happening. What isness is not changing. Isness is the experiencer, you know. Isness experiences happenings, you know. It's all perfect. It's all perfect. Bodies, personalities, the world cannot experience any happening. It's ridiculous. If we saw this, we wouldn't be, you know, chasing after death, planning, you know, people. If you looked into people's plans, if you're really honest, if you're totally honest, you can see what everyone's doing, really. And you can see that they are moving towards collective suicide, sacrifices, parties where people decide to all die together. As things get really nasty in this world. Things are getting pretty nasty in California right now as far as gasoline prices go. You know, I mean, they're getting close to $5 a gallon right now. What did I pay for? $4.69 today. Something like that, or $4.67. I guess I got a bargain. I bargain shopped. And, you know, some stations are closing because they don't want to get stuck with high-priced gasoline when the prices drop. And they pay all this high price for gasoline, and people won't buy it from them. They'll get stuck with it, and then the price drops, and they'll have to drop the price way down. They're going to lose a ton of money. So they're closing the gas stations. Weird, huh? Very weird. Gas is available, but they refuse to stock it because it's too expensive, and people won't buy it. And they feel people are going to wait, you know, as much as possible until the scarcity is over, kind of thing. That's just a baby crisis. But the crises that are coming in the world, you know, are knockout crises. And so people, you know, will say, hey, this world isn't happening for me anymore. I don't think it's going to be happening for me. Meaning, this is really messed up. It's really messed up. But if you can listen to some sharing of truth, which is happening here to some extent, you won't look at it that way. You'll realize nothing's ever happened here. So why despair? It's exactly the same as always been. And the problem is that people believe they have to find a happening here, and they see the world coming unraveled, and they feel they can't find a happening here, won't be able to find it. That's when they turn to death. They say, well, at least I could control my death. Let's make that happen. And other people get together and say, the more people get together and die together, the more happening it'll be for us, you know. And that's the problem. That really is the problem. There's a culture of death right now. There's a culture of suicide right now. Very bad. Very bad. People don't realize how bad it is because people are sensing the future is unraveling, and it is. And yet they don't have the tools to the wisdom, the inquiry, the satsang. They don't have that, you know, they haven't accessed it. You can't force it upon them. You lead a horse to water, you can't make the horse drink. If they did, they would not believe that death could be happening either. What's death happening to the body, the personality, all this stuff? And no happening can ever happen to the impermanent. So it's just another gesture of futility. Just another one. Needless, too. And you look at a lot of people, they seem very confident in the future, but the truth is they're actually feeling confident in their plans to have a happening in some way. A lot of them, those plans are sacrificed to die, and they're confident that that'll be a happening. So they seem, you know, unconcerned. No, I'm going to have a happening is what they're saying. But the wise ones know that even dying is not a happening. So they're looking for unconditional love as the happening. See? Big difference. Let us not be Kool-Aid drinkers, you know. Absolutely not. That's complete folly. Complete folly. And yet, you know, the uneasiness in the world, we realize, oh my gosh, the world is really heading towards collective suicide. Really is. The wheels are coming off. You know, people go about it in all different ways. I mean, war is like collective suicide, isn't it? What are people in war doing? They're trying to have something happen for them. Really? Why do people play these video games, these violent video games? They're looking for something to happen to them, you know. You know, if they, you know, annihilate, you know, this amount of stuff, blow it up, annihilate all this stuff, they'll feel like maybe if we get high enough score, you know, maybe I'll feel like something happened. Something happened. Something really happened. Something really happened. So of course everybody's frantically, you know, trying to have something really happen. Nothing will ever really happen here. Nothing has ever really happened here. Ever. In the past and in the future either. Never will. No chance of it ever. It's already the case. You know, so why pursue that? Why not pursue choosing a new idea and experiencing the happening of unconditional love? And then, you know, you are. Something is happening. Not coming from the world, no. But it's an overlay of the world. So you can be in the world but not of it. You won't be despairing. You won't be part of some suicidal cult. You won't be any of that. In fact, it'll be the remedy. You'll help lead people away from that. Of course, a lot of people don't want to be led away from that because they're convinced that is where they will find something that really happened, something that will really happen. They're leaving the world as some real happening. You know, their ascension off the planet is some real happening. No, it's not. Only unconditional love experience of that is a real happening. Within, you know, the context that we're talking about of existence and all this stuff, you know, it's the overlay of all that, overlays it all. So, you know, it's the most practical way of speaking of a real happening. So these talks are serious business because the plans that people have for the future are very, very self-destructive. Very self-destructive. The civilization, the world is imploding. It is going towards self-destructivity. And you look at these pop icons, these idols, you know, everybody, you know, that is has these positions of influence in the world over so many people. So many people are so interested in them. They're highly self-destructive people and personas, very self-destructive. And they are conditioning people to be self-destructive. That is what they're doing. That's why, like, I pay no attention to them. I have zero interest in those, all these famous people. I have no interest. I just look at, they're very self-destructive. I have no interest in that, being self-destructive. But they're literally patterning, very carefully patterning a whole justification and defense and mindset and focus and putting blinders on so people are going to believe that being self-destructive is a happening, is a real happening. It's not. It's not at all. And yet this appears to be an inconvenient truth to those who are on that path of seeking. It's just another path of seeking. Equally futile. Equally futile. Inflicting pain on yourself. All these people piercing, you know, and tattoos. Why they do that? Because they're trying to have something really happen. I mean, it's incredible. Absolutely mind-blowing how many people have tattoos now. Absolutely mind-blowing. When I grew up, I did not know a single person who had tattoos. Not even one. And you come across like a sailor, you know, somewhere in a city or something, and like you see a tattoo, it was like you've never seen before in your life. It was the weirdest thing you've ever seen. It was like we went to like an amusement park in Ocean Beach in San Francisco, and you see some old sailor there, you know, running to one of these arcades, and they had like an anchor tattooed on him, and you're like, oh my gosh, and we'd all be like it was the most incredible thing we've ever seen. Craziest thing. Why would someone put a tattoo? And now, you know, every single day, I see hundreds of people with tattoos. Constantly. Not just one. Their whole body's covered with them. Their arms, their neck, their legs. It's just like totally commonplace now. Not just a few. You know, maybe someday I'm going to count. It might be half the people out that I see now just going around the world have, you know, tattoos somewhere. You know, men and women, both. Why are they doing that, you see? And piercings, all sorts of piercings everywhere, you know. That was something that was a fad, you know, and still some people are into that. But tattoos is an even bigger fad. They're trying to have something really happen. That's it. They think by inflicting all this pain, you know, they have the record of their happening. Like a tattoo is a happening for them. They think it's a happening. And they have all this collective cult of tattoo I don't watch television, but I watch baseball, and you can get the gist of what's, you know, the promos and trailers and all this stuff. And there are ways to be aware of it without actually watching it. And they're constantly trying to find ways to work tattoos into all the popular media and entertainment culture, because it's a symbol of a happening. It symbolizes, hey, I had a happening here. I got a tattoo. That was a happening. And then people, you know, eating ghost peppers. That's another big fad of inflicting pain on yourself in some way. And we think, hey, it's a happening. I even tried that, eating a ghost pepper. And I talk about it with people, yeah, it's like a happening. I was just seeing, you know, the zeitgeist of the times, you know, what's going here, and help clarify it. I said, ah, okay, I see. Yeah, it's people want to try to have a happening. Yeah, you know, what happens is an endorphin rush. So there's all these massive subcultures that aren't even subcultures anymore. They're mainstream, and people are just trying to have a happening. They're trying to have something happen, something real happen. It never does. It never does. And you can say that about all the stuff that's going on in the world right now. All the social experimentation. I saw a man today, my age, maybe a little younger than me, in a store today, wearing a skirt. Literally. A t-shirt and a skirt, you know, a crazy skirt. And he's like, you know, trying to look half man, half woman. And everyone's just saying, you know, Why? Why? Because he's trying to have something real happen, you know. And this whole diversity thing we're into, you know, it's, again, everybody's desperate to have something really happen. Desperate. And nothing is happening at all. Nothing's really happening at all. Which is why I'm just sitting here, just, you know, doing these videos. And I know these videos are not happening, but I'm not out trying to have some happening, except I did eat the ghost pepper. As, you know, as a seeing, I guess, of just looking at that whole thing. I knew it was silly. Wasting time, spending time, you know. But just that clues me into it, the whole thing. You know, I don't expect every people to have, you know, no attempts to have any happenings at all in their life. Everyone's going to still be trying to have some sort of happening in their life, whatever it is. All these, you know, the hookup culture, you know, what is that? It's, again, everyone's trying to have a happening or something really happening in their lives. Muji said that in Theravada Malai, during the satsangs, there's more hookups there than any place in the world. Why? Because they're feeling like nothing's really happening here. Here we are with Muji, we're in the satsang, we're in Theravada Malai, where Ramana Maharshi's ashram, you know, was and is, and this is the most spiritual place in the world, and we're supposed to have something, something's supposed to really happen here. And nothing is really happening, and so they're hooking up with each other. All these hookups, unbelievable amount of hookups taking place, because they're desperate to try. And, you know, we gotta, something really has to happen, you know. And they go home and they say, did something really happen? The answer is no, nothing really happened at all. Which is the point of the whole thing, actually, is to realize that nothing ever really happened there. And then you see it differently. Say, whoa, wait a minute, you know. And it's like, holy cow. Presumably, Muji knows this, the whole thing takes place anyway, of course. The whole song and dance happens. But the realization is that nothing really happens here. Nothing's really happening here. Nothing ever really happens in this world. But by choosing unconditional love, overlaying all this non-happening, that is a happening. See, that is a happening. But that, you can choose that anywhere you are. You will choose that when you realize that it doesn't matter where you are, nothing's going to happen to you other than choosing unconditional love. Then, you know, then, okay. But this whole, you know, this, everybody's desperately trying something right now. Desperately. They're watching all these TV shows, you know, all these reality shows, these contest shows, everything, you know, the Food Channel. You know, they're trying to want something to really happen to me. Come on, we got everything now. It's got to happen. I got 1,000 channels on my, you know, my big plasma screen. I know people are getting, what, plasma screens are, what, 80, you know, 80 something inches diagonal plasma screens, or LED screens, or LCD screens, liquid crystal diode, I guess, LCD, 80 plus inches, you know. But why? Because they want something to really happen to them. By taking lessons, doing this and this and that, they're drinking, you know, 1,000 bottle wines, $1,000 a bottle. They're driving these cars that are $400,000 a piece. Why? They have mansions, they have all this stuff. They want something to really happen. They're desperately trying to have something really happen. And nothing ever really happens to them. It doesn't, you know. But, you know, we assume that these people with, you know, doing all this stuff, whether it be the super rich people or the super tattooed, pierced drug people, you know, hookup people, you know, whatever, that something's really happening for them. We assume it. But don't assume that. I look at them, not assuming anything. Yeah, I've been around these people. I mean, maybe that's part of my, you know, my life right now, is I'm around a huge cross-section of the entire planet, you know, and I just sit there, just objectively, just look, just notice, and I realize, no, nothing's ever happened to any of these people. from the people at the top of the penthouse, the people in the outhouse. Nothing has ever happened to any of them. So our assumptions are incorrect. Don't assume that anything's happened to anyone here. Don't assume it. I look at Ananda, my ma, I know something has happened there. See, I saw that, I said, wow, something has happened here. No question about it, but this is completely different. Something has really happened here. And then said, why, how, why, what's going on? You know, was it where she was born? You know, I can go through that whole thing. Maybe I will. Maybe I'll make a video, but I'll point out, you know, that where she was born, all the places she went, you know, in Kiora, and then to Dhaka, and, or Dhaka, as they say it, and then going to Vindhyachal, and Dehradun, and Hardwar, and Kankal, and, you know, Kashmir, and traveling everywhere. And maybe that was the happening. No, none of that was the happening, because I've researched it all, and I realized it wasn't there. The ashrams where you know, all these are ashrams, there's nothing happening there. There's nothing happening there at her samadhi shrine. And maybe I'll make a video of all this stuff and show this to you, you know. Nothing. It's not in this world anything's happening. It's in unconditional love is the happening. And she was experiencing unconditional love. So that's what was happening. That's what was happening. She said, you have no idea of the love I have for everyone and everything on this planet, everyone in the universe. She says, without exception, tiniest speck to the greatest thing, that is no difference. It's equal everywhere. It's love, she said, that I have. It's immeasurable love I have for everything without any differentiation whatsoever. That was her confession. That is experiencing unconditional love. That's what she was experiencing. So what was really happening for her wasn't coming from this planet. Wasn't coming from the dogs and the cows and where she was and, you know, trip going this place and that place and that place. And maybe I can do a video that, you know, shows all the various places and things in the atmosphere. And you can check for yourself, which I've done. Didn't come from those places. Spent years and years and years studying all this. I think, did it come from India? Did it come from Bangladesh? Did it come from where she was born? Did it come from, you know, the shrine she went to, the places? Did it come from this or chanting? Or where did it come from? It came from simply that she desired not to try and be prime creator. She allowed reality to be what it is. And it came, and then choosing that ideal of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to this overlay of existence, unconditional love. She chose that. That's where it came from. That is where it came from. And she needed to choose that to even show up in this world. Because actually she didn't even need to choose that, but she wouldn't have shown up here. In order to appear in this world, you have to choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Whereas in reality, why would anyone choose that? They wouldn't, you know, it's only a remedy for the idea of trying to be prime creator. The remedy is to choose to not try and be prime creator, not desire to be prime creator. So she didn't, in her case, she didn't have the desire to be prime creator and then had to heal it. She knew that the world had this desire to be prime creator. And she didn't have any such desire, but she then chose the desire to not try and be prime creator so she could form and a personality could appear in this world. And but what she was experiencing was overlay of the universe, unconditional love. She was actually beyond the universe. Reality, universe is not reality, universe is a dream. So what she was is beyond the universe, but appearing in the universe as unconditional love, overlaying everything here. Yeah, so we can do the exact same thing. We can choose to not desire to be prime creator, not to try to be prime creator, and that will give rise to unconditional love overlaying the entire universe. We can do that too, absolutely. In fact, we have to do it. We have to do it. Now, we may not be perfectly at ease with it, as Ananda Mayama was, because for us, it's a remedy. For her, it was simply compassion and grace. She didn't have to come into the world, only did so to help us out. But for us, we do need to choose unconditional love, because we chose the idea of trying to be prime creator, and it's given rise to this, you know, delusion that we have. So we do need to, and we might not be, you know, as perfectly at ease with it. Not perfectly at ease, but the ease will come, but it will be a situation where our ease gets better and better and better and better and better. And she did say, when you're talking about the ease, you know, this question of how at ease am I going to be with it, she said, leave me out of that entirely, because I'm a different situation. I'm not one who had to choose that idea of not having any desire to be prime creator. I didn't have to choose that. You do have to choose it, so you won't be as at ease as I am. So leave me out of the equation with that, she said. Don't compare yourself. Don't compare yourself. So we're at a good place, we're at a very good place, and that we're able to get into this very high kind of base camp here of considering this type of talk. And I know it's been a good one. I feel it's been a really good video. I could go on and on, but you know, this is enough. It's enough. It seems like a good stopping point. I'll wait a little while to see if anything else comes up. You might feel like, well, nothing's really happened here. Of course, it hasn't. But what we have seen is that nothing will really happen here, right? And we're feeling okay with that. So that's very fortunate. Very auspicious. It's very auspicious. Very auspicious to feel okay about that nothing happened here, nothing really happened here, and nothing ever really will happen here. But, and yet to see, to be able to generalize it and see that nothing ever will really happen here, the capacity to generalize it, which is what we've been doing, with no exceptions, that is extremely auspicious. And we may be feeling a little let down, saying, ah, nothing really happened here. I spent an hour and almost 2 hours watching this video and nothing really happened. Of course not. Of course not. But what took place is a generalization and a feeling of okay with that generalization. Which means you save a ton of time to being okay with accepting that nothing has ever happened here, nothing will really happen there ever. So I don't need to keep waiting for it. That is futile. It's useless, stupid. Why? Let me just choose a new idea. Unconditional love will be a real happening. So you're feeling more okay with that than before, which is saving you an incredible amount of time, because you won't be searching for something to really happen so strongly, right? You won't be going down to get another tattoo or your first tattoo, you know. You won't need to be eating, you know, a ghost pepper. I made some vinegar today with a ghost pepper, my biggest ghost pepper, the very best one. I looked at it, it was, looked so incredibly hot. I was just showing it to everybody. I said, look at this. But the fact is, I didn't give it to anybody, because I said, you know what? This is gonna fry you, and I'm not into frying my friends. So I didn't give it to anybody. I gave the other ones away. I knew they weren't as hot, but this one I knew would be just mind-blowingly, scaldingly hot. So I said, what do I do with it? I'm not going to give it to anybody. You know, draw a line somewhere here. So I said, what do I do? I said, I'm going to infuse it. At first I thought I'd infuse it in oil. But then I read that oil, it has no acidity to it, and it can contain botulism and toxins over time. And you have to consume within about a month. And I said, there's no way, it's too fast, because I only want to use a couple drops at a time. So what I did was I used vinegar, balsamic vinegar, garlic, some regular bell pepper, yellow bell pepper, garlic, salt, sugar, ghost pepper, and balsamic vinegar. And got it in a bottle now, big bottle, empty bottle of Tabasco sauce. Got it in there. I've tried a few drops, and it was fantastic. Fantastic. Gave this tingling feeling into your mouth that lasted for like an hour or two or something. It wasn't even hot. It was just like, wow, very nice stuff. So that's what happened to that ghost pepper. No, nobody's going to be fried from it. Because I knew in the back of my mind, it's like, hey, that's not right. You know, don't try to give somebody a real happening, because you know that's folly. It'll just be pain and it won't be a real happening. At the same time, we don't have to go overboard and try to deprive ourselves from anything we think might be happening either. That's just the opposite stupidity, right? I'm going to prevent myself from having any happening. It's like sitting in a cave, you know, those people who do the austerities. I've watched those videos too. I recommend, you know, if you want to look up that line of research, where these yogis do all sorts of austerities, you know. Oh my gosh. I mean, you can see them on YouTube now. It's unbelievable. This stuff's been going on for thousands of years. You know, some guy rolling along a road for thousands of miles. You know, some guy standing up for like years and years and years, never lying down or sitting, standing for years and years. Someone holding an arm up for years and years and years and years, never letting it down, you know. All sorts of piercings, you know, incredible stuff. All this stuff. And you look at them and say, has anything really happened to them? No. You can see plainly and clearly nothing has ever really happened to them. No, not at all. So you don't need to try and say, well, I'm gonna, you know, fast for 40 days on water, or, you know, because I don't want anything, I don't want to pursue any happening. The non-pursuit of happening is itself not a happening. So you can just be as you are. I had this ghost pepper. I said, I spent a lot of time growing it, and it was fun. I don't want to just throw it out. You know, so let me make some, you know, vinegar, and I'll put a couple drops, you know, on my food and flavor it. Incredible flavor, fantastic flavor. Okay, I know it's not a happening, but I'm not going to get wrapped up in trying not to pursue any happening, because that itself is a pursuit of a happening. You know, it really is. We think that by not pursuing a happening, we're going to have a happening. That's not the way it is. What we need to pursue is clarity about the entire situation. And generalize it with no exceptions. We don't have to, you know, try and deprive ourselves of sleep, live in a cave, act weird, you know, different. Same way we don't have to go around piercing ourselves, you know, either. We don't have to be on health nuts, you know. A lot of people get in, become health nuts. We don't have to be that. We don't have to, if we're health nut, we don't have to stop being that. Whatever we are, we don't have to stop being it, okay, doing that. But just like with that ghost pepper, I said, hey, you know, hey, draw a line, listen, and said, there's a limit here. And let's just be smart about it. And don't try to lead anybody else thinking that they're going to have some kind of real happening if they just increase the intensity. You know, I gave some peppers to some people, they had them, but I knew it wasn't going to be so bad. And they said, yeah, it was really hot, but it wasn't that terrible, you know. But if I gave them that really, really big, incredible one, it would just fry them. So I said, no, I'm not going to do it. They said, can I have it? I said, no. Someone tried to take it, and I said, no. You're not going to have that one. No way. But people think that more and more intensity is the answer. Let's have more tattoos. Let's hook up with more people. Let's have more drugs. Let's have more music. Let's have more raves. Let's have more smartphones, more apps on our smartphone. That kind of stuff. Whatever it is, let's have more television, watch programs. Let's have better food. Let's go crazy with foodie stuff. Whatever it is. Let's start wearing dresses. Men start wearing dresses or something, you know. Is that gonna end, be a real happening? I mean, you can do that. That's everybody, you know, get transgender operations. Is that gonna be a real happening? No, I've seen, you can look at transgenders. Do they have something really happen to them? No. Or let's get all this augmentation. You know, I mean, the amount of augmentation and cosmetic stuff's going on is unbelievable. Mind-blowing, right? What people are doing to themselves. Injecting themselves with all sorts of stuff. Body modification is a huge thing right now. Why? People are trying to have a real happening. Something really happen. Really happen. There's no limit to what people do. People are, you know, mutilating themselves, doing every imaginable kind of thing of just, you know, crazy stuff. And you can just see it all as one. You don't have to judge it except say it's all an attempt to have something really happen, and it's all completely futile. That is the final judgment. It's all equally futile. Okay. As is trying to avoid all that stuff too, equally futile. Only unconditional love is a real happening. So you can sit, you know, in purity in a cave for your whole life, and still nothing will have really happened to you at all. You can, you know, eat macrobiotic organic stuff to the max, you know, and let your hair grow into dreadlocks. Let your hair grow for your whole life and just turn into dreadlocks, and you can even be a guru, but nothing really happens to you from any of that. You can live in a tree, you know, or you can be a lunatic and blow people up, or you can start wars, or you can be a politician. You'd be an actor, an actress, anything, you name it. You can do any of that stuff. Nothing's going to really happen to you. Futile. And of course, we're here. You know, we got to do something. The best thing to do is satsang, inquiry. That is the best thing to do. Because that is not happening either. It's not a real happening either at all. But it's pointing out that nothing is a real happening. And it's pointing out the remedy to that. So it's different. It's not a real happening, but it's different. It's very different because it points out the remedy. The other stuff doesn't point out the remedy. The other stuff just says more intensity. You know, if one ghost pepper doesn't do it for you, eat a bigger one. And if that doesn't do it for you, eat two of them. I know people eating like four at a time or something. It's like just about killed themselves, you know. They keep trying and keep trying and keep trying. You know, more and more intensity. Give me a hotter one. I want to find a hotter one. You don't need to do that. So if you're in satsang and inquiry, it's not like you're going to become, do nothing at all. But you're going to play satsang inquiry first. And you're going to back away from the stupid intensity thing, you know, thinking, you know, like there are people like think if they play every golf course in the world, then something really happened to them. Or if they play like Augusta, you know, National, that something really happened to them. You know, I know people have, nothing happened, really happened to them. You know, this thing about, you know, if we just get on this golf course at this time of day, if we just go up the Bandon Dunes, you know, and play all the courses up there in a certain time of year, and you know, something really happens. Something really happened, but you look at the people. I know somebody who's been on the Institute golf course. Very few people have. This is in San Martin in California. And I've known people played Cyprus and Monterey. And I talk with them. Nothing really happened. Nothing really happened there. We assume something really happened. No, did not. So hanging around privileged people can be helpful because they've had all these experiences and you can see nothing really happened at all. You say, oh, yeah, I played Cyprus. How was it? Oh, it was great. Unbelievable place. Best greens I've ever played on. You talk them a little while long, you realize nothing really happened to them at all. Nothing's ever happened to them in their entire life. And you're in Silicon Valley here, you're around all these, you know, famous, rich movers and shakers, you know, high-tech titans and stuff, and you realize nothing's ever happened to them. Nothing's ever really happened to them. And in existence, nothing ever really will, other than choosing the idea of unconditional love, choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator and the effect of is unconditional love. And you can do the exact same thing, no matter who you are, what you've been trying to do. Whether you're a chili head, or a tattoo freak, or a hookup maniac, or a, you know, whether you're playing the role of a guru, or whether you're a business person, or whether you're a social radical, or you're conservative, or you know, whether you're a, you know, a instigator of war, or a warrior, or a gamer, or a smartphone freak, or druggy, or you know, just a normal blah suburbanite, or you're into this ism or that ism. None of that matters. No matter what you are into, right this moment, you can choose to drop the desire of being prime creator. Choose the desire of not trying to be prime creator, just the desire to be as you are, as you isn't. Be what you are. I mean, be as is. Be I am that is. Let reality, choose to accept reality as it is. And unconditional love will arise for you, and then you really will have something happening for you. That will be happening for you. It really will be happening for you. And all the rest of the stuff that you did before you realize, not only what you did was never really happening for you, but everything that everybody else has ever done has never really happened for you either. Or for anybody else. There's never been any thing really happen in the universe. Nothing. So you can say it's all one non-happening. It's all one non-happening. That's what it is. Talk about one. It's all one. It's all one non-happening. It's all this vast, just one non-happening. And so it doesn't really matter what any particular person has done, what you've done, or anyone else has done. It's all one big non-happening. Or one small non-happening, and one nothing, one non-existent non-happening. Whatever. It doesn't matter, right? Word games don't matter. Because the happening is unconditional love. That really is happening. So again, as you are right now, you can see that the entire universe is all one non-happening. That can be gotten too. That can be gotten too. That picky, which is what we are advancing upon. Generalize. It's all one non-happening. No exceptions. No exceptions. What we're getting to in these videos, I've done almost 200 of them now, is really no exceptions. Don't make any exceptions. No exceptions. It's all a non-happening. It's all one non-happening. No matter what. Even all the gurus are not in this world are non-happening. From our standpoint, you see. For them, they're experiencing unconditional love. They're not even in the world. I mean, they realize the world's a non-happening. They're perfectly aware of that. Okay. But for us, from our standpoint, all the gurus ever in the world, the saints, the sages, the avatars, you know, the holy people of all traditions, etc., all complete non-happening, not really any real happening there at all either. No exceptions. No exceptions. Even the crucifixion of Jesus was a non-happening, not a real happening. Not a real happening. See, only unconditional love is a real happening, and it is an overlay of existence. It doesn't arise from existence. That which arises from existence is never a real happening. There's no real experiencer. Existence cannot produce an experiencer of existence. Or, you know, it's all impermanent. It's all impermanent. There is no real happening whatsoever. Never has been, never will be. And somehow, this generalization can, at some point, crystallize in some way where we then see it as one non-happening. Therefore, we realize we can hand it over. It's something we can hand over. As long as we are struggling, thinking there's exceptions, you know, it's not all one non-happening. We think that we got to hand some of it over, and some of it we have to keep. And therefore, it becomes extremely awkward to try and hand it over. When we see it all as just one non-happening, it's like we can hold it, you know, right like this, and we can just then set it over there and say, okay, we just set that there, and we pick up unconditional love. It becomes completely easy for us when that, seeing it as all one non-happening. At that point, then we are able to hand it over, as it were, exchange, make an exchange. The desire to be prime creator, exchange for the desire to not be prime creator. And we exchange this one non-happening for a real happening, which is unconditional love. That exchange then is made at that point. So the generalization is all important to get to really not making any exceptions. When we can really get to the point where we're willing to not make any exceptions, the exchange will then automatically take place. It will take place. So, as we keep training ourselves to think, to consider it, consider there are no exceptions, we're literally getting very close to that exchange is going to take place, even though it hasn't yet, because we're still maybe holding out a little hope, a little exception here and there. You know, maybe I can find some guru and it'll be a real happening for me. You know, maybe Jesus will come back and that'll be a real happening for me. See, that kind of thing. No, it will not. Real happening for who? You know, for this person? For the body, etc. Spirit. Well, we've already gone over all that. It will not be a real happening. Only on the unconditional love, overlaying all of belief, is a real happening. So, doesn't matter what happens. Jesus could come back, and all the angels could come back, and everyone could rapture, and the Armageddon could happen, all that stuff. None of that will be a real happening. None of it. It's still a complete zero. Complete zero. Doesn't matter what happens. The whole universe could melt down to nothing, or it could all arise again, or waves, you know, all that stuff. Nothing. It's nothing. No real happening at all. None of it. When we get to that point where we'll feel okay with that, we know we're very close to making an exchange, because then we just see it's just one little thing here. We can wrap our mind around it as it is, as it were, you know. We comprehend it. We get it. We see exchange is possible. Exchange is possible. And then the moment we exchange is possible, then probably, boom, we'll exchange it. I'm still not at that point. You know, close for sure. But I'm aware that this is the issue, is making an exception. If you make an exception, you cannot make the exchange. Cannot make the exchange. When you realize there are no exceptions, the whole thing becomes completely light, like a light as a feather. If you think there's an exception, the whole thing still feels like massively weighty, because how did that exception occur, right? So the whole weight of the universe is on you. Or you see, there's no exceptions. It's like, you know, like a feather, like a piece of dust. You can just, you know, it's light as a piece of dust. Then you say, easy to make that exchange. Just, you know, don't need that. Don't need that. So it's all about not making any exceptions whatsoever. And so we have all these, you know, hopes, you know, I think, hey, maybe Ananda Mayama will come back in the world, and that'll be a real happening for me. It will not. It will not. Not at all. Not at all. Maybe Jesus will come back. Will that be a real happening for me? No, will not. Will it be a real happening for someone else? No, it will not. Will not. Maybe if we see everybody being raptured, will that be a real happening? It will not. Maybe we see planet, you know, being hit by something, or a comet causing pole shift. Will that be a real happening? No, it will not. We see if everybody's starving. Will that be a real happening? No, it will not. We see everybody killing themselves. Will that be a real happening? No, it will not. We see all these wars. Real happening? No, not. Not. Not this, not that, not that, not that, not that, not that. And then at some point, the crystallization crystallizes, and then it is a piece of dust. Just a piece of dust. And those who that has happened to, they tell us, assure us, this is true. But we need to articulate how to get there, which is what these videos are, showing you no exception. Why no exception, you know? Some have gone through so much searching that they finally just, you know, they've got to the point where they just poof, you know, it's all futile, and they make the exchange. But they don't really understand quite why. They just know that they reached that point where they just dropped it all, you know. Eckhart Tolle, he just dropped the pain body one night and he just dropped it, you know, and just doesn't know why really, you know. Well, see, in these videos I'm articulating very clearly what's behind all this dropping of it, so to speak. Why we have difficulty. What I want is to save time for everybody and all their searching. You don't have to be one of those who just searches everywhere. You do not. You don't have to go life after life after life. You don't have to build up so much pain that you just finally just drop somehow. You don't have to do any of that. You don't. You can wise up. You can see very clearly the situation, and you can ask yourself, hey, do I really want to, you know, you can say, wait a minute, do I really want to keep on testing every flavor, you know, eating every food, trying every experience that comes in existence, keep trying, you say, well, wait a minute, no, maybe not. So the whole deal is saving yourself time. You can do it if you just keep on in existence for a long, long time. Eventually, you just, boom, you know, you say, it's all equally not happening. There is no real happening here. And you make the exchange. But you can make the exchange long before then. You don't have to put yourself through all that torture. Do not. So saving time is what it's all about, which means focus on generalizing, listening to someone who's honest enough to say, no, that's not going to be it. Going to see this teacher's not going to be it, that teacher's not going to be it. But of course, you're going to go see them anyway. But now you realize that the realization that this is not it is a profound realization, but that profound realization is not it either. But it enables you to generalize, and maybe you say, you know what, I don't have to go again. I don't have to make that pilgrimage again. In fact, I don't need to make any pilgrimage. And you start generalizing more. You say, wait a minute, I don't even have to go into the future at all. You know, that in the future is not going to be it. So why do I even need to any future at all? I don't need to be experiencing any of that stuff. You know, and you start generalizing, and then just suddenly, wow, you know, suddenly you have saved yourself, you know, incredible amounts of time and suffering and misery. And then you can say, I can choose unconditional love right now. I can do that right now. Why not, you see? So, saving time is what it's all about. And I do believe these videos are saving people a great amount of time, actually. I know I'm saving myself a tremendous amount of time and suffering and misery, etc., no doubt about it. And we can end with the honesty of realizing this video wasn't really happening either. Which is okay, which doesn't mean it was a waste of your time. It means it saved time. But of course it wasn't a real happening. And the next one won't be a real happening either. And the next one won't be a real happening either. There's no movie or video you'll ever watch that'll be a real happening for you. So honesty is the path that saves you the most time, saves you the most suffering, is honesty. And so we're bringing that here. All right, very great. That's it for this video.